Let's take a look at the assumptions when constructing confidence intervals for the population mean mu using the T procedure. Suppose we use this confidence interval formula to construct a confidence interval for the population mean mu. The subject of this video is, when is it reasonable to use this method? For this method to be valid, we require, first of all, a simple random sample from the population of interest, and it's always going to be important to have a good sampling design, regardless of the sample size. Second, we need a normally distributed population. Although this assumption of a normally distributed population will not be important if we have a large sample size. And for the remainder of this video, I'm going to investigate this normality assumption in greater detail. What happens if the population from which we are sampling is not normal? First, some terminology. A statistical procedure is called robust to violations of an assumption if the procedure still performs reasonably well when the assumption is violated. Robustness is a very good property for a statistic to have because very often the assumptions are not perfectly true. When we're sampling from a distribution, it's not going to be perfectly normally distributed. The good news is the T procedures are robust to many violations of the normality assumption. This means the T procedures work well in a lot of spots even when we are sampling from a distribution that is not normal. But the T procedures can perform poorly if we are sampling from a distribution that is strongly skewed or if there are outliers, especially for small sample sizes. Here's a very rough guideline. If the sample size is greater than 40, the T procedures work well in most practical situations. This is not a hard and fast rule, as we can construct scenarios in which the T procedures work poorly even for samples of this size. But in most practical situations that we encounter, the T procedures will work quite well as long as we have a reasonable sample size. If the sample size is a little smaller, between 15 and 40 say, the T procedures can work quite well, but they can also break down if there is strong skewness or outliers. If the sample size is smaller still, less than 15 say, one should be wary of using the T procedures. It can be reasonable to use them if we are quite confident the population is approximately normally distributed, but it's always a little bit dubious using the T procedures for very small sample sizes. If the normality assumption is violated, what are the consequences? The true confidence level will be different from the stated confidence level. Let's take a look at what I mean by that using simulation. We're going to simulate samples from four different distributions. One of them is the normal distribution, so the normality assumption will be perfectly justified. The other three have deviations from normality, and we're going to investigate the effect of those deviations from normality on our confidence level. In this simulation, I'm going to draw 100,000 samples from each distribution for each of several different sample sizes. And for each sample, I'm going to calculate a 95% confidence interval for the population mean mu. I'm then going to ask myself the question, what percentage of these intervals actually contain mu? And if this percentage is close to the stated value of 95%, the procedure works well in that scenario. And if the percentage is quite different from 95%, the procedure is not working very well. In this simulation, I've simulated values from the normal distribution, so the normality assumption is perfectly justified here. And in this column, I have the percentage of those intervals that actually contained the value of the parameter mu. And we can see here that we get 95.1% and 95.0 on these different sample sizes. The only reason those don't all equal exactly 95% is due to sampling variability. I randomly sampled 100,000 samples for each sample size. So it's not necessarily going to equal exactly 95% in my simulation, but theoretically those percentages are exactly 95%. Now let's look at situations where the normality assumption is violated. Here we are sampling from the uniform distribution, and so the normality assumption is violated. And we can see here that at samples of size 5, we'd be stating a 95% confidence level, but only 93.5% of our confidence intervals actually captured mu. So the true confidence level of our confidence interval would actually be a little bit less than the 95% that we're stating. But as the sample size gets bigger, and up to 20, well, now we're getting awfully close to 95%, as well as at 50 and 100. So for small sample sizes, the true confidence level might be a little bit less than what we are stating at 95%, but that effect goes away as the sample size increases, and we don't need a very large sample size before it gets very close to 95%. Note that the uniform distribution is perfectly symmetric, and it doesn't have long tails, and so it doesn't result in many extreme values. And recall that the enemies of the T procedure are skewness and outliers, and neither of those are a problem for the uniform distribution. So it's not a surprise that even when we're sampling from this distribution, the T procedure works quite well. Here we're sampling from the exponential distribution. So once again, the normality assumption is violated. And this distribution has some right skewness to it. And we can expect the T procedure to perform worse here. And that's what we see in the simulation. For sample sizes of 5, we're going to be stating a 95% confidence level, but the true confidence level is going to be quite a bit less. In this simulation, it was estimated to be around 88.3%. But as the sample size increases, this confidence level that we see in our simulation gets closer and closer and closer to the stated value of 95%. But note that there's nothing magical about the number 30 or 40 or 50 or 100. Even at 100, our confidence level is a little bit less than what we are stating at 95%. Let's look at a different violation of the normality assumption here. Here we're sampling from the distribution in blue, whereas the red curve is the normal distribution. And we can see that this distribution has heavier tails than the normal distribution, but it is symmetric. For samples of size 5, 96.8% of the simulated intervals captured the true value of the population mean mu. So it looks like the true confidence level is actually a little bit greater than what we're stating at 95%. But once again, as the sample size increases, we see the percentage of intervals in this simulation that captures mu getting closer and closer to the stated value of 95%. To sum up, when we are sampling from a distribution that is not normal and we are using the T procedures, then the true confidence level of our interval might be quite different from the one we are stating. This effect is especially problematic if we have some skewness, and it's especially problematic for small sample sizes. A couple of notes to finish. I suggest checking the normality assumption with a normal quantile-quantile plot. Some sources suggest carrying out a test of normality, but for a couple of reasons, I prefer to do a visual check of normality. And on a different note, even if the sample size is large enough for the t-test to be reasonable, there may be better statistical methods available. For example, if we are sampling from a distribution that is exponential, then we should use inference procedures based on the exponential distribution and not rely on large sample approximations of the t procedures.